Thank you, organizers, especially Dr. Goria, Dr. Ranjit, for selecting me as a resource person for such a nice conference. So forensic nursing and geriatric, this is the topic that is assigned to me. So forensic nurses, from the last one day, we are talking about forensic nurses, how they are doing, how they have started the work and the different aspects. So forensic nursing, they apply nursing science to public or legal proceeding, so that the forensic aspects of healthcare, they are combined with the biopsychosocial education of registered nurses in the scientific investigation and treatment of trauma and death of the victims for the perpetrators of abuse, violence, criminal activity, and traumatic accidents. So forensic nurses are the nursing trained persons, they are working for the different aspects. So forensic nurses often uncover information about abuse or violence against the elderly, because we have to talk how the forensic nursing work in the elderly people, geriatrics. So it's the forensic nurse's professional responsibility to identify and appropriately intervene in elder maltreatment cases. This is given by Lantz in 2011. So forensic gerontology specialists work to raise awareness regarding legal and human rights issues. They also typically work in the hospitals, nursing homes, and other facilities. They are dedicated to caring for the elderly people. So now first we should understand what is the elder abuse. So elder abuse is not clearly defined. So one definition is given by WHO. This is, we can also call it elder maltreatment, mistreatment, senior abuse, abuse in later life, abuse of older adults and the women. And is a single or repeated act or a lack of appropriate action occurring within any relationship where there is an expectation of trust which causes harm or distress to an older person. So single episode of victimization can tip over the otherwise productive, self-sufficient older people's life. As in the old days, some, they have the fewer sports system, like physical sports system, psychological sports system, and economical. Because in the old days, sometimes there's a single partner left, one person after death, their psychologically sports system is weak. So this is a vulnerable time. If single episode happens of the abuse, it will give a very bad impact on them. So impact of abuse and neglect is magnified and more likely to trigger a downward spiral leading to loss of independence, serious complicating illness, and even the death of the older person. And many times even death of the old person give any suspicion, because we thought that maybe death is due to the aging process and due to the age. But sometime death of older person, they occur by some abuse. So if we go about the prevalence of elder abuse, WHO states that 1:6 people over 60 years were abused based on the examined study from 28 countries, which indicated a pooled prevalence of 15.7%, and this is too high. If we talk about in India, so study has made some observations that in India, more than 1/5 of elders have experienced elder abuse, and around 7 out of 20 has been its victim on the daily basis. And it's very quietly horrifying figure that daughter-in-law and son are the major culprit behind the abuse. And during the COVID, elderly face increased risk of physical, sexual, and psychological abuse and exploitation of their finances due to competitive care in the families when the sources of families are decreasing due to poor earning. Even this study was conducted by Dr. Goria only. He has reported the findings. And elders has been deprioritized in the healthcare setting during COVID-19. Also, sometimes they have not got the good patient care. And human rights violence of elders were more discernible during that pandemic, and it was increased up to 37% in some of the countries during that pandemic area. So study, it was found that elder abuse and neglect significantly shorten older victims' lives, even controlling for all other factors. So elder abuse is a harm done to the older person by someone in a social relationship, and it may include physical abuse, psychological abuse, financial abuse, sexual abuse, and the neglect. Sometimes they occur all the forms at a single time. So if we talk about the different, what is physical abuse? This is slapping, pushing, beating, or force the confinement. Sexual abuse, sexual assault, or any unwanted form of sexual activity. Mental abuse, treating the older person like a child, or humiliating, insulting, frightening, threatening, or ignoring the persons. Financial abuse, stealing, fraud, extortion, misusing a power of attorney. And along with the abuse, the neglect is also considered as abuse if it's failing to give the older person the necessities of care, such as food, medical attention, or the abandoning. Because sometimes if they have the chronic illness in the old age and people are not getting the good medical facilities, like not proper management of diabetes and the hypertension, and person is not get a food according to the timing, it considered as a neglect. Or if the most common type of abuse faced by elders are neglect, disrespect, verbal abuse, ignorance, and physical abuse like beating and slapping. So what are the sign and symptoms of elder abuse? If we have to, as a forensic nurse, we have to observe that, or we have to see this is the abuse. So bruises, broken bones, other injuries, signs of restrain, refusal by the caregiver to allow the visitors. For the sexual abuse, we can see pain, bruising, swelling of the anogenital area, and sexually transmitted infections. Psychological abuse, verbal abuse such as shouting and insult, signs of emotional upset such as agitation, anxiety, and withdrawal. For the financial abuse, sudden changes in will and other financial documents, bank accounts or banking practices, unexplained disappearance of funds or the valuable possessions. And for neglect, malnutrition, if we observe poor hygiene, inadequate living conditions, untreated medical. So if we see who is the victim, like we have to find out those persons who are more vulnerable to this abuse. If the person is widowed or living alone, person is in social isolation, female over 75 years, physical or cognitive impairment, like in the old days, sometimes the dementia occurs in the persons, dependent on caregiver. And who will be the abusers? Abusers, most of the time, they are the family members. Like women, more likely to be abused by spouse or the ex, like 35%. Men by adult child, paid caregiver, if they have the servant, nursing homes or healthcare providers, and the other residents in that area. And it can be the close relative or a caregiver, may have substance abuse problem, the care abuser, or they have history of mental illness, be dependent on the older person for the system, or be resentment of caregiving role. Like person don't want to do the care of the old person. And if there is a financial problems. So some abuse, they come under the criminal code, like physical abuse. If there's assault, aggravated causing bodily harm, use of weapon, forcefully confinement, murder, and manslaughter. Sexual abuse, if again, there is assault, aggravated, and use of the weapon. Psychological, intimidation, threats, and the harassment. For the neglect, criminal negligence causing bodily harm, death, breach of duty to provide the care. So there are the forensic markers that we have to find out if we have to take care of the older person. So forensic markers, there are no gold standard tests for the abuse or neglect exist. So those working with the abused or neglected elders, they have to rely on the forensic markers that we have to find out. There's often a great overlap among the markers of disease and the neglect. And sometimes there is a abuse. So I will give you the example. If person is having the diabetes and person is not getting enough insulin, so then it will go into the ulcer development and patient will have the amputation and all this. So this is neglect. This is a marker of disease, but person is not getting the treatment, even though the children, they know that this is the necessity of the disease, then it lead to the abuse. Sometimes neglect is so profound and widespread that caretaker is knowledgeable of what was needed, but not provided to the person. And that went considered as a abuse. I have already given you the example. So that time we have to find out, this is the aging process, this is the neglect, or they both when they combine, sometimes it goes into the abuse. So potential forensic markers for elder abuse are neglect, including the abrasions, lacerations, bruising, fractures, wrist stains, weight loss, dehydration, medication use, burns, cognitive and mental health problems, hygiene, and the sexual abuse. Financial fraud and exploitation also coexist with the physical and the emotional abuse and the neglect. So forensic marker, when we have to find out, we have to do the actual observation of the bruises or the fractures. Then we have to make the conclusion. So conclusions will be based on the underlying observations. Like if we see the vaginal tear or abdominal bruise, that it can be a sexual abuse. And if we see that person have poor hygiene and the burn marks, so it can be conclusion that person maybe have the neglect in the family, and with insufficient light vision, person has to do all the work that lead to burns. So some markers are potential risk factors like self-neglect, cognitive and mental health problems, and the financial abuse. So other indicators for the neglect, decubital ulcers, patient have the weight loss, dehydration, hygiene issues, and the medication issues. So for that, we have to do the forensic assessment. This is the main role of the forensic nurse. So nature of the current assault and history of abuse, risk assessment we have to find out, mental and emotional health, and forensic physical examination, and collect the forensic evidence. So for the exam purpose, confirm the recent contact between the individual or the objects. Lagarde's principle we have to find out, to note evidence of physical force and the neglect, and to identify the other person involved in the contact. And what is Lagarde's principle? I think everybody knows, when a person or object come in contact with another person or object, there is a possibility that an exchange of material will take place, cross transfer of evidence, trace or DNA, if properly obtained and examined, and this will give you the powerful and reliable evidence in any type of trauma, violence, or a crime or abuse. So forensic evidence we have to collect. What will can be the sources of evidence? Clothing, body evidence, and genital and anal evidence. So how will we do that? So head to toe examination of the client has to be done with undressed. Inspection of the client's body, noting area of tenderness, swelling, decreased range of motion, change in level of consciousness, and indications of trauma. Palpation for areas of tenderness, identification and detailed description of the injuries, collection of the trace forensic evidence as required, like fiber, hair, swabs, and sexual assault evidence kit can be used if we suspect the sexual assault. So this is the sexual assault evidence kit. So then we have to look for the wounds. Four type of blunt trauma can be present. Abrasions, it can be scratches or grazes. Bruises can be there. Laceration, tears but not cut. And fractures can be there. This we have to see as a forensic markers. Then most important is the documentation of injury. For that, we can use a body map, give a detailed description of the injuries, and document areas of tenderness. And then we have to specify type of injury, location, size, color, and pain. And forensic photography is also very important. So we have to pre and post treatment if possible, photograph injuries acutely, and after 2 to 3 days later, treatment of any injuries like sutures we have to done if there's an open wound, and follow rule of three, identifying photo, name of the victim, nurse, date and time, photo of the patient, and close up of each injury with and without a forensic ruler. This is very important if you click a photo for a evidence. And what interventions forensic nurse can do? The risk assessment and the safety planning. And she has to address acutely the person. If person need any shelter, that it has to be arranged in the old age home. And if person needs any hospitalization, it has to be done. And any complications that's ongoing, that has to be taken care of by the forensic nurse, like what can be the alternative that can be used to save the patient. And cases need a multidisciplinary approach that has to be seen. If it's hospitalized medical care, then a hospitalized care has to be given. If some legal help has to be taken, that has to be taken, because sometimes the legal matter is also involved. The criminal code is also available, involved in that. So the nurse has to take care of all this. So for the refer or consult acute cases, she has to see cases acute and the chronic. Any client who is the victim of known recent physical assault 1 to 2 weeks. Any client who is the victim of known sexual assault within a past week. So that we consider as a acute, non-acute. Any client who is the victim of ongoing physical, sexual abuse or neglect, but doesn't mean the acute case criteria. But sometimes you come across after the passing of 1 or 2 weeks, that time we say it as a non-acute case. Accordingly, we have to refer. So many times in the elder abuse and the neglect, we see that cases are not reported. People don't report to the healthcare providers, to the other persons. So what can be the reasons? Because victim always feel the shame, the guilt, fear. Report will result in even worse treatment for the abusers, because I have already seen the abusers, mostly the family members and the person who are residing with that or in the old age homes where people are living. So I feel that if we report this to the higher authorities, I will even get the worst treatment. So that's the one fear that they don't report and want to protect the perpetrators, who is often a family member. Sometimes son or daughter-in-law is involved. They don't want to tell the other person that my family is not taking care of me. Unsure of where to turn for help. They don't know. They don't know their rules. They don't know the different facilities where they can approach. The lack of awareness of elder abuse and failure to recognize and report it when it does occur. This is the main lack of awareness. Like in our scenario, the awareness is very, very less. People are not aware. They always feel shy. They always have the guilt and they don't approach. Sometimes feel this is my fate. That's why my children is not taking care of me or this is happening to me. So lack of education, lack of knowledge on what constitutes maltreatment. Even the definition of maltreatment, neglect is not clearly defined and they don't know this is a maltreatment. And even this is stated in 2011, elder maltreatment and neglect is dangerously underdiagnosed and underreported. So this is very much important. This elderly people, their abuse, their neglect is underreported. So we don't have the actual figures. We can say this is the true prevalence or incidence in the society. Even nursing homes, we can protect the elder abuse if the nurses are posted over there, creating social solid patient care policies and the procedure, fostering frequent visits from the volunteers and the social workers, installing quality monitoring system, regularly training employees on elder abuse and neglect issues. So for the conclusion, elder abuse is a complex issue which occurs in all environmental setting and require nurses caring for older people to be able to detect its occurrence and initiate appropriate responses. So this is very, very complex issue that has to be taken care. As the world faces a global demographic transition, the fundamental right for all human beings is to live in a safe environment. So this is very, very important. Older people, they want a safe environment there where they can be physically, psychologically, mentally are satisfied and live a happy life. So gold standard for responding to elder abuse, collaborative, intersectoral, multidisciplinary teams of health and social service professionals who can address the potentially complex and diverse needs of abused older adults. This is not a one person can do that. This is the collaborative approach where multidisciplinary persons has to work together to take care of the abused older adults. So well-trained forensic nurses can serve as one critical component of a comprehensive response. So this is the main important thing. This is a summarization. The well-trained forensic nurse can serve as a critical component of a comprehensive response for elder abuse and for the care of the elderly. This is the main role of forensic nurse in the geriatrics. So to care for those who once cared for us is one of the highest honor. This should be the, we can say this should be the aim of the life, that we have to take care of the parents so that they will not feel abused. And if they will go that, the forensic nurses, if families support that, they have the less work for the geriatrics. So otherwise, forensic nurses have a very important role to find out the elder abuse in the home, in the old age homes or in the hospitals, and they have to take care of the persons. With this, thank you so much. So elders need the safe life.